Tony.
The Facebooking and the tweeting and the Instagramming, all that would not exist without our understanding of science.
So it's amazing that you do that as an insult.
You mean true for you is different from true for anybody else? Have
yeah, absolutely, because I can't
think either got to be true or not.
I can't, no, no.
Welcome back to ORLY Radio 124. This is the B-side edition, recorded Friday, September 2nd. Yep, still September 2nd, 2016, where we dismantle the current events for your edutainment through mostly rational conversations that will make you go, oh, really. I'm your host, Andy Cowen, and I still have Stephen Griffith and Daniel Atherton with me. Thank you, gentlemen, for returning. And
thanks for having us.
Oh, boy, we're... Yeah, here we are again. Ooh. Oh...
Well, I need my fiber,
man. I don't think we left anything out of the last episode. We definitely had plenty to go through there, but now here we go into Law and Order.
Hello, veggies.
We actually had some good news, really, but in true legalese fashion, you don't know that it's good news until you get to like the third paragraph. So, a closely divided court
this
Wednesday.
This brief may contain good news.
Yeah, that's right. This brief may contain good news. SCOTUS blog had a little analysis on the North Carolina issue. North Carolina has, in recent times, really become... I don't know why anyone would want to live there anymore.
It's
yeah, certainly
North
not.
Florida.
It's north, just North Florida?
Yeah.
Oh, move your mic closer to your mouth, I think.
I see.
Ah, much better. Now we hear. Okay, so, a closely divided court, Wednesday, denied North Carolina's request to allow the state to enforce three provisions of its controversial 2013 election law when voters go to the poll for this fall's general election. So this is a change from what they had put in for the primaries versus the way it's going to be in the general. The law would require North Carolina voters to show a government-issued photo ID, reduce the number of days for early voting, and eliminate out-of-precinct voting, same-day voter registration, and pre-registration for young voters. Basically, anything that would make it easier for people to vote. Anything. Any of those things. A federal court of appeals rejected the state's explanation that the law was intended to combat voter fraud and promote public confidence in the election system. I don't see how that could promote any confidence in the election system.
No, it doesn't.
So rather, the court of appeals concluded, quote, the law, quote, hinges explicitly on race, specifically it's concerned that African Americans, who had overwhelmingly voted for Democrats, had too much access to voting.
They're not wrong.
No. They're not wrong. So you can follow up with that. Again, it's a legal brief about more legalese. So I think that I've got everything that you really needed out of it. But there's so much more.
Look at Southern Poverty Law Center.
Yes.
They've been following this very closely. I follow them, and I get updates on stuff coming out of North Carolina about every other day.
I was reading some of their stuff on this very thing before the show, and they're pissed. I mean, the wording... The wording at SCOTUS blog is respectful,
clinical,
you know, proper bedside manner when you're telling someone that they have 3 days to live kind of thing. But Southern Poverty Law Center, SPLC, no, they got no bones about calling out the shenanigans and calling out names and saying exactly what they are, who they are, what they've done, and they should all feel bad and you should feel bad. You've done a bad thing, you should feel bad.
When they see racism, they call it racism.
And this is blatant racism. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so go ahead. Just, you know, take a look. It's all good. All right, so let's see. And also, moving along down to Florida now. This is, again, good news, which is surprising. Usually we don't have so much good news in the legal section.
No.
It just leaves more room for other things. But a federal judge on 8/19/2016 permanently blocked parts of Florida law that aimed to cut off state funding for preventative health services at clinics that also provide abortions. That would be Planned Parenthood, for those of you not following along at home. Because, oh, look, we have a Republican governor who is...
No, we don't have a Republican. We have Voldemort.
Well, I was going to get a little more descriptive as to what classification he actually is, because Republican does not go far enough.
No.
But, you know,
he's alt-right.
That's what we... Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, he is what he is, and unfortunately we have to deal with him more often than some of you folks in other states. So Rick Scott, that bastard, him and his cronies have definitely been on the warpath to prevent Planned Parenthood from actually existing, which is, again, part of the whole ultra-conservative movement to do anything they can to hamper abortions, including getting in the way of general women's health. And that's really what this comes down to. Though, let's look at this one other way, too. Remember that Planned Parenthood is about parents, plural. So they also take care of men's reproductive health as well. If you happen to need a vasectomy, you can get one at Planned Parenthood.
If you want to get tested for HIV, AIDS, you can go to Planned Parenthood.
You don't even have to be a parent. You don't even have to be planning to be a parent. Or you could be planning to not be a parent, and they would still take you. That's the nice thing.
They can also help you not be a parent.
They can. They can also help you be a parent. They can give all sorts of counseling. They're not there to judge you. They're there to help you. So,
and it's one of the things that we do terribly in this country, which is preventative health.
Yeah.
They do it, and they do it well.
Yeah. Really, they're a very effective service. Now, if people...
A necessary service.
And, you know, if people would stop putting giant signs with, you know, bacon-looking fetuses on signs and things like that out in front, they'd be even more effective at the preventative health side. Because there's some people that simply won't go because they think that they're going to be ostracized, because they think that people, anybody going in there is obviously going to be a baby killer and having an abortion. That's the mindset of anybody that goes to Planned Parenthood. Well, you're only going there for an abortion. When that's really a low number of the actual number of services they provide. Several previous shows have actually quoted actual demographics of, you know, the percentage of operations that are performed and things like that. And it's preventative health is by far more than 50% of everything they do. Yeah, I think it was 3%. The chat room. I think that was in
it
the
is
neighborhood.
Three.
Yeah, so. Everything else that they're doing, let them do it, okay?
Yeah.
You know, they're following government regulations on everything. Otherwise, they wouldn't be able to take federal funds. You know, that's a thing. And they cannot, by law, use the federal funds that they take in order to perform abortions. That's by federal law. It's a thing. You guys already got that. And look, they're still open doing other things. Anyway, that's a soapbox that I could just stay on.
Oh, yeah.
It's big and comfortable. Lots of room up here.
That's because it's been built so large and so wide.
That's true. It's roomy.
Hi, ORLY Radio listeners. This is your host, Andy Cowen, calling my voicemail to make sure that it still works. Please consider calling us 470 8222-6759. Bye.
Now, unless you guys had anything else to add to our legalese section about what's going on in Florida or, of course, what's going on in North Carolina, I think we can move
and
on.
True. Not for me, because it's been a fairly decent week that, again, you hit a couple of highlights that I think is all that needs to be heated. It's been, I think the next few weeks are going to get real interesting, but for this week, no, it's been a pretty good week.
Yeah. Actually, did I mention... No, where...
Wait to hear what goes on with the...
Oh, that's down in the bad ideas.
The Native Americans.
Yeah. There's... Yeah, the Native Americans with the... our First Nations
pipeline.
Our First Nations people. And
we'll do that next week.
Yeah, the pipeline. Yeah. Or, of course, we could talk about the ever-present, you know, I'm going to sit down because I can during the national anthem because I'm protesting. And the giant vitriolic rage over that and it taking up all the news cycle versus not talking
versus
about
actual news.
Yeah.
Though on a side note by that, I love all the veterans and people who are standing up going, no, we side with Kaepernick.
Yeah. No, we fought for his right to do exactly that.
To sit down.
Yeah.
You guys can stop yelling at him.
Congratulations. You're making us all look like jerks.
It's time for another good idea, bad idea. Good idea.
Is this a good idea? Brazil's president being impeached?
Yes.
I think it's a good idea.
Actually, as I'd love to say, there's a lot to unpack here.
Well, we have talked a great deal about some of the shenanigans that were happening in Brazil and the votes of no confidence and, you know, everything going haywire. But go ahead.
This is an Alice in Wonderland rabbit hole of corruption and madness. If you want something to do as a writer and have a framework to just work off of, this is the thing to look at. This is an entirely new spin on your West Wings and all of your political thrillers, because this is crazy.
Well, yeah, you know it's crazy when looking at it, the Brazilian senators voted 61-20 to impeach her.
Also of note, this is actually the most conservative government in recent history that was democratically elected.
Yeah.
You need those qualifiers. But no, this is the current Senate is insanely conservative. Rousseff got her hands caught in a cookie jar, but they don't. The very interesting thing is when the vote for impeachment, they didn't really provide much evidence. They didn't have a solid argument, but they did still pass the impeachment.
Well, they have they have a lot of scrutiny and a lot of scandal over and over and over and over.
Oh, yeah. But in the evidence that was actually presented during the impeachment session, there wasn't much solid evidence. It was more hearsay. Even though you have investigative journalism that's been going on and getting solid evidence.
The country's judiciary branch carried out a massive anti-corruption sting, this is in 2014, in Brazil's quasi-state oil company Petrobras. The mission was called Operation Car Wash, and authorities uncovered that corrupt politicians from all leading parties had siphoned over $2 billion from the company to pay kickbacks and favors for Brazil's elite. Do you need to go further?
But
you know,
here's the thing.
I think that would be enough.
It gets even weirder. Because the previous president was just tried and convicted of corruption.
Whoa.
And
wait a second.
He is not allowed to run. for 8 years. That's all his punishment. He's not actually even behind bars. He hasn't even been fined.
That's weird.
Even though he's guilty.
That's weird.
Yeah. The only punishment he suffers is he can't run for 8 years.
Now, I will say that she did beat out our Congress in getting a favorability rating lower than 9%. She hit 7%.
Oh, yeah.
Massive protests broke out across the country as a general rage over the scandal hit fever pitch. Some citizens even called for a return of military rule.
Yep. Military rule has been something that you've seen throughout the history of South America. It is bloody. It is insidious.
And they wanted it back in favor of her. They would rather have it than her.
Yeah.
There is stability.
Wow.
Throughout their elected officials, because, again, when democracy hit, yay, we are free! And then, well, the politics of corruption start coming in. And more of the years. It's really hasn't started to set root in Brazil until the late 90s. And then it just keeps accelerating. To now, everyone's frustrated. The citizenry is just incensed, and there's not an honest politician to be found. Everybody, this is just how politics works in that country now, but it's being brought to light. And it's causing this massive upheaval.
So some are calling it a coup, including Rousseff.
Herself.
Yeah. Coup or not, what's clear is that Brazil's political and economic problems will not go away with Rousseff's ouster. Inflation and unemployment are still high. The prices of commodities, the country's main exports, are still low. Analysts at HSBC believe the market's attention will quickly turn from Rousseff to fixing Brazil's economy through key and sometimes painful reforms. You know, I imagine they're going to be in a lot of pain trying to fix everything that's busted.
Well, also, you're looking at a conservative government, which is probably going to push for austerity, which, as we know, austerity only works if you are in an incredibly strong economy, not a weak one. Yeah. You got to spend your way out. And so depending on what their government does, if they got some smart people, they may be able to weather this. But if it is a truly conservative government and they're going to use traditional conservative economics, Brazil's in for a real rough time.
Well, that's obvious, but they were saying, you know, and I was unaware of that, her predecessor, who we were talking about, Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, the one that was not allowed to run for 8 years, he was also her mentor.
Yep.
So they got rid of him and got her, who is just a shadow of him.
Well, she marketed herself as being different.
But she lied.
Yes.
What a shock. She's a politician.
In Brazil.
In Brazil. Hey!
Again, Brazil is actually, especially in certain regions of Brazil, there is a stark contrast between the haves and the have-nots. I can't remember. Oh, it's Paulo, Sao Paulo.
Mm-hmm.
The wealthy get around traffic by taking helicopters. This is just a thing.
That's pretty. If I could, I would. I mean, really. But yeah.
No, the well-to-do, the wealthy, the well-off, they can afford to do this, while everybody else is stuck in some of the worst traffic in all of South America. And you have favelas not too far away from Sao Paulo.
Mm-hmm.
It is just a stark, in-your-face contrast of everything wrong with the nation.
Hmm. It's definitely kind of in your face about it. Okay, so that was it's a good idea to get her out. Now we get to see what happens.
So. What replaces the corruption?
Perhaps tinfoil hat. Perhaps that's what we could replace it with. Or, as scientists would like to do, come on down. Check out HARP. Go ahead. It's really not a giant mind-controlling weather machine. It's not. Not at all.
It's not the Weather Dominator from G.I. Joe?
It is not, in fact, that at all. So, this is out on Gizmodo. Scientists invite conspiracy theorists to check out the alleged mind-controlling weather machine. Which, you know, has been shut down, by the way. So for decades, tinfoil fashionistas.
Okay, that's cool.
Your hat is not shiny enough, sir. It is not shiny enough.
Tinfoil fashionista.
You best put that inside out right this second.
Oh my god, that's hilarious. Okay. Have attributed a number of sinister happenings to the atmospheric research program known as HARP. H-A-A-R-P, including hurricanes, earthquakes, and even the destruction of the Space Shuttle Columbia. After this week, however, it will be a lot harder to entertain those claims. Not really for the flat earthers. No, that's not really going to happen. They're still going to be crazy. But on Saturday, the supposed weather-altering secret weapon is holding an open house. Now, this already happened. This was out on 8/25. But, you know, I had to bring it up here. Quote, yeah. We hope that people will be able to see the actual science of it, a spokesperson from the University of Alaska, which now operates the facility, told Alaska Dispatch News. We hope to show people that it's not capable of mind control and not capable of weather control and all the other things it's been accused of. I don't think that's going to happen. According to KTVF, the university expects both scientists and conspiracy theorists to show up at the event. With any luck, that will include former Minnesota governor and professional wrestler Jesse Ventura, who questioned whether HARP was being used for mind control in 2009 after being turned away from the facility's gates. Yeah. Minnesota governor.
Former
Minnesota governor. I think we still just call him.
Though
governor.
I will say he does have his good moments.
Yeah,
he's also a little bit on the far side. To be honest here.
A little bit. Yeah. Quote: This thing can knock planes out of the air, said Ventura at the time. It can control the weather, and it's very dangerous. Dangerous weapon. Ventura and his ilk should find themselves more than welcome. According to the university, children of all ages are invited and refreshments will be provided.
Nice.
Children of all ages, including Mr. Ventura. Please,
don't, whatever you do, don't drink the chemtrail.
Don't drink the chemtrail. It's concentrated when it's not in gaseous form, so you got to watch out for that stuff. Absolutely. At least that's what the government conspiracy handbook has told me. Because, of course, we're nothing but shills for them. And obviously, I'm still waiting for my check to arrive, however, because I'm not being paid in any way for these endorsements.
They owe a lot of back pay.
They owe. Oh, boy, do they owe. And amazingly enough, teen pregnancy down due to education and contraceptive use. Who would have thought that? Is it all possible?
It's the whole, look, we now have science backing up what anyone who's been intelligent actually has known. This story broke a few days ago. The one I linked here is actually from NPR where, teen pregnancy is way down, and a study suggests that the reason it is increased and an increasingly effective use of contraceptives. Again, they found that while the amount of sex teenagers are having has not actually changed, and it hasn't gone down, it may have gone up just a hair, abortions have been going down, and they're going, okay, what's the reason? And they see constant improvement in contraceptive use. They're seeing more contraceptives being used. They're seeing doubling up, like, okay, she's on birth control, he uses condoms, etc. We're seeing all these things and education of how to use these things properly being used among teens who, let's be honest, did you listen to your parents when you were a teenager? Probably not. You know,
it's
sex
a teenager
is going to
thing.
It's natural.
It's what you're supposed
occur.
To do. Yeah.
So again, but educate people so they know how to use things properly. So, and that's what this is showing is they, you know, the education's there. Give them access. Show them how to properly use it, and they will because they don't want to get pregnant. They don't want to cause pregnancy, and they don't want to get disease. So
yeah. So this
education works.
This study
surprise,
was published.
Surprise.
Study was published online in the Journal of Adolescent Health. I love this. By definition, quote, if teens are having the same amount of sex but getting pregnant less often, it's because of contraception. Really? I mean, come on.
No, the sad thing is not the fact they said that. The sad thing is they had to say that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, yeah, as I get, they mentioned something here. Valerie Huber, who advocates for programs that urge teens to wait to have sex rather than provide information about contraception, says the study is biased toward birth control. In quotes, as public health experts and policymakers, we must normalize sexual delay more than we normalize teen sex even with contraception, said a statement from Huber, president and CEO of Ascend, a group that promotes abstinence education. And further quote, we believe youth deserve the best opportunity for a healthy future.
No, you don't. You believe in getting government funding to teach your stupid stuff.
You believe sex is evil, sex is wrong.
They don't
think
that people should be having fun by touching their naughty bits together. In that way. That special way.
And yet, every bit of science we're seeing now from just basic physiological science to psychological health and everything else is showing, hey, are you not asexual? Okay. Then engaging in sex on a regular basis is actually really good and healthy for you.
And yet also
it's
kind of
vital to your mental health.
These same folks would definitely also, they would ignore any possible genderqueer possibilities.
Oh, good
so
heavens.
So anybody that happens to be actually asexual is still abhorrent to them. Even though they very well may be doing exactly what they want, which is not having any sex. It's like, really? Really? Oh. More recent policy changes could help drop the teen pregnancy rate even more. One is the Affordable Care Act requirement that boosted insurance coverage for contraception starting in 2012. The other is the 2014 recommendation from the American Academy of Pediatrics that sexually active teenagers be offered long-acting reversible contraception methods, such as implants and intrauterine devices, which are highly effective and do not require any additional action, such as remembering to take a daily pill. Yeah. It's good. It's good stuff.
No, and the science behind them, and this is where actually capitalism works, because people are having sex. People are using contraception. So there's money in that market. So there's now science is developing better and better contraceptives. We're getting better condoms in their designs. We're getting better IUDs. It's all coming about because there is demand. Demand's not going down.
That's true.
And don't forget new advances in contraceptives, especially for men. I have been following Vassal Gel for years before it was Vassal Gel, and I'm still wanting this to come out. Because how would you like to have all the effectiveness of a vasectomy, 100% contraception, and it's 100% reversible, and doesn't require surgery?
Down with it. Yep, that'd be good. That would definitely be good. I like this line, and this is a perfect way to end this little segment here. In the end, the best method for anyone is the one that they are willing and able to use. If you are willing and able to simply not have sex, then more power to you. I don't know a single teenager that would be willing to do that. Able?
Yeah.
Probably. Maybe many of them would be able to do that simply because they do not have a significant other. you know, they simply may not be able to.
They don't have the opportunity.
But, oh, are they willing? Are they willing to have that other partner? Oh, yes. So, use what works for you. And if that happens to be all the contraceptives all at once, then I'm not going to stop you. I think that'd be a good idea. Well, maybe not a good idea. Please consult a physician before you take anything. And make sure that you're put in physically good health before engaging in sexual activity. Heart health and all that fun stuff. Okay, let's hear from our friends at GSoW. Or not. That could be a broken link, too. Yep, it's a broken link. So, skip that.
Look, at least you know what's wrong with that one.
Well, I don't, because it's just doing exactly the same thing that the others did, so...
Oh, unfortunate.
Bloody hell. Okay, so, moving right along into...
Bad idea.
Bad ideas. So, free trade talks between the European Union and the United States have failed. Germany's economy minister said Sunday, citing a lack of progress on any of the major sections of the long-running negotiations. I am not very up to date on the geopolitical nature of the free trade agreements between Germany and the United States. However, I imagine that someone on the panel may.
Let's put this simply. What basically is happening is that wonderful thing that we uncovered, quote, uncovered, a little while ago, the TTIP, the European version of the one for Asia, is essentially fracturing and falling apart.
The thing that's, I don't know why Obama has gotten into his mind, is a big part of his lasting legacy, and he must get through, is this free trade. Now,
oh, hang on one sec.
Yeah.
Note the signs. There are acronyms TTIP that we have not addressed yet.
Yeah.
There's, that is the Canadian European Trade Agreement.
And the TISA?
That one I am not familiar with.
You're not familiar.
TISA.
TISA.
TISA, yeah, it's a lower I.
Trade and Services Agreement.
Oh, dear.
Hello, rabbit hole. How are you?
Oh, dear.
Could be even... Yeah. Center for Research on Globalization touts it as, the new trade deal could be even greater threat to public services than TTIP.
Oh, my God. Jeez, here we go again.
It was not one thing, it's another.
Here we go again. So...
They are trying to get this stuff through by any means necessary.
Oh. Whoa, okay, so check out the map here. Of the TISA participating countries.
Europe. Pretty much Europe. Certain sections of South America. All of North America.
Under the origin section here, the process was proposed to a group of countries meeting in Geneva and called the Really Good Friends.
Are they the Super Friends?
The original members of the Really Good Friends group were Australia, Canada, Chile, Chinese Taipei, Colombia, European Union, Hong Kong, Japan, South Korea, Mexico, New Zealand, Norway, Pakistan, Singapore, Switzerland, and the good old US of A. Singapore has since left the Really Good Friends group, and the following members have joined late in 2012. Costa Rica, Israel, Panama, Peru, and Turkey. Really good friends.
Huh.
Turkey's in there.
Yeah, right there.
Proposed agreement. This agreement covers about 70% of the global services economy.
Oh.
Wonderful.
Wow. So this is... If the TTIP and the TTP... TPP... Yeah. You know,
TTP,
the Trans-Pacific Partnership and... Yeah, the TTP. Okay. If those fail... Then we're still not out of the woods, folks. Oh, no. There's another one. 23 parties.
And it's all based on service industry.
And would you look at that, it was another WikiLeaks thing.
Yep.
These are all being kept very hush-hush.
And guess what? most of America's industry is now moved towards service. So who would lose? Us.
Wow.
And CETA, Robert? Is the Comprehensive Economic and Trade Agreement.
Comprehensive?
Between Canada and the European Union.
Now, one of the things to note, when it comes to free trade, Robert Reich did an excellent little video not too long ago when it comes to understanding free trade. Economists are always for free trade because of efficiency. The more efficient the system is, based on math and principle, it's a good thing. Especially when those who are benefiting the most can compensate the losers. However, this free trade fails to solve three problems. One, and probably the most important, the winners don't compensate the losers.
Only the losers compensate the winners.
I can't find the video, but I will link his actual article
also
in the show notes.
The other thing is, the winners have been winning for so long, and the losers have been losing for so long, that there is such a disparity that free trade now pretty much only benefits the top percent. It has no benefit for those at the bottom.
That is a very difficult case to argue. That's the way it is. You look at the facts, and you don't face it in an emotional way.
And the third thing is, and this is where the math does not lie. You can test this as hard as you like. Unless you're changing all the numbers, it doesn't lie. And those at the bottom, inflation has not caught up with the losses. Our wages have not caught up. Things are not on track as they should be. So wages have stalled, except for those at the very top. And the other more sinister thing is, if you go a little bit further down the rabbit hole, is that our tax money is actually going and helping benefit the winners.
Check this out. So I'm continuing to read in the Trade and Services Agreement here.
Oh,
and
dear.
Dr. Patricia Reynald, a research associate at the University of Sydney, said, "Amendments from the U.S. are seeking to end publicly provided services like public pension funds, which are referred to as monopolies, and to limit public regulation of all financial services. They want to freeze financial regulation at existing levels, which would mean that governments could not respond to new developments like another global financial crisis."
This is terrifying.
They're blaming the U.S. too on this. Which, we may be at fault.
I will take this at face value, because most of these proposals are coming out of the U.S. and these are being written by corps. Most of these free trade agreements are being voted and written up by those who gain the most to benefit from them. These are not written for the common man. These are written for corps.
What is the WTO?
World Trade Organization.
World Trade Organization. Okay, so regarding the secrecy of the draft, Professor Kelsey commented, "The secrecy of negotiating documents exceeds even the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement and runs counter to moves in the World Trade Organization toward greater openness." Johnston adds, "It is impossible to obey a law or know how it affects you when the law is secret." Well, yeah. So, should you really be interested in looking at a rabbit hole and things that would have been conspiracy theory 5 years ago? but are now very real, then, yeah, the European Services Forum, the Russia Effect and Trade Legislation? What is that?
No idea.
Trans-Pacific Partnership, and of course the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. All of these things will definitely spin your propeller heads.
And by all means, if you want these things to not happen, contact your local congressman. Contact your state senators. Let them know that, hey, you're not cool with this.
Oh, that's what it is. Ratchet effect is an instance of the restrained ability of human processes to be reversed once a specific thing has happened. Analogous with the mechanical ratchet that holds the spring tight as the clock is wound up.
Okay, huh. Once it's done, it's really hard to go back.
It is related to the phenomena of featureitis and scope creep in the manufacture of various consumer goods and of mission creep in military planning. Ratchet effect in sociology refers to the tendency for central controllers to base next year's targets on last year's performance, meaning that managers who expect still to be in place in the next target period have to preserve incentive not exceed targets, even if they could easily do so.
Have a perverse incentive not to exceed targets.
Yeah.
Even when they could.
Right. So, wow, that's an area of study.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. This is terrifying.
Wow, yeah. So, I didn't even mean to go down that rabbit hole. But it's...
Dude, you talked about free trade with us. You know what this is.
Well, yeah.
Again, I'm being
but
pushed
I didn't
more
expect
and more
the...
to go back to school to get my economics degree.
I didn't expect the floor to be pulled out of me by finding two more plans. Two?
No, see, that's the problem. The floor was never pulled out from you. The floor never existed. You just didn't look down.
I didn't realize I was Wile E. Coyote. I didn't realize that I had already run off the cliff. I did not know this. Oh, man. Okay, so let's see. Things that I have to add to the meta tags for this episode. TTIP, TISA, and CETA.
Economic alphabet soup.
Oh, boy. Man. So, yeah. Should you be interested, there is a search on the webpage, and you can plug in some of these topics, and it will pull up the shows that that we talked about them, as long as I did the due diligence and tagging everything properly. So that way you can hear us facepalm over and over again at the wonderful things that they have wrought. With that, I don't think that we even need to talk about anything more here. Was there anything to pull out of this other than maybe they're failing? Maybe they're just going away.
What we're seeing from this article is that some economists, at least over in Germany, are going, this is insane. This is not good for the people. No, we're not going to agree to this. And since the UK is doing their Brexit, Germany pretty much has all the cards when it comes to the EU. So if Germany says no, it's more than likely not going to happen. So as long... Now, other countries outside of the EU may sign on to these agreements. Which, again, getting any of this stuff passed is bad for any nation that's a part of it. Because this is putting more and more control of the law into private hands, not public hands.
Gabriel, one of the people involved in this here, said he noted that in 14 rounds of talks, the two sides haven't agreed on a single common item out of 27 chapters being discussed. Why are you even at the table anymore?
It's because this is Obama's legacy, and he wants to get it done.
It doesn't matter that the other side's not listening. He just wants to hammer it home until they capitulate.
Just keep swinging. Don't give up. Just keep swinging. Well, he learned that trick from the Republicans in Congress. So, yeah.
Yeah. This is this is how American politics has shifted.
Yeah.
It is not about concessions. It's not about actually doing politics anymore, where we come to a compromise. It is, this is what we want. We're going to keep hammering it home until you either pull a gun on us and shoot us, or you give in.
Gabriel accused Washington of being angry about the deal that the EU struck with Canada, known as CETA, because it contains elements that the U.S. doesn't want to see in the TTIP. We mustn't submit to the American proposals, said Gabriel, who is also the head of Germany's center-left Social Democratic Party. Well, that would be somebody.
I'll have to look at CETA now.
That would be somebody that knows. Gabriel's ministry isn't directly involved in the negotiations with Washington because trade agreements are negotiated at the EU level, but such a damning verdict from a leading official in Europe's biggest economy is likely to make further talks between the EU executive and the Obama administration harder. Yeah, probably. Gabriel's comments contrast with those of Chancellor Angela Merkel, who said last month that the TTIP was absolutely in Europe's interest.
Well, Merkel has been a huge supporter of Obama and now recently Hillary, so I'm not surprised at that.
Yeah.
As a quick thing, if approved, CETA will eliminate 98% of trade tariffs between Canada and the EU.
That's not healthy.
And has attracted controversy due to its role for investor state tribunals.
Now, okay, beyond that. How close are there in the European Union, part of the freedom of commerce and all that stuff, there are no trade tariffs between countries, are there?
No, you get access to what is referred to as the single market.
Okay, so does this nearly puts Canada as an equal footing?
It brings Canada into the single market.
Yeah,
that's what it does.
Interesting.
It fosters them in, much like Norway. Norway does not necessarily abide by the EU laws, but still has some, not full access, but partial access to the single market. And that's what. Partly what the Brexit was about is that Britain wanted to be Norway.
Mm-hmm.
We want to have access to the single market, but without having to abide the rest of the rules. But they went about it in such an ugly way, they're not going to get it.
No, definitely not.
While Norway's was more reserved, and it was done far earlier on when the EU was in its infancy.
Man, this is interesting stuff. Just the chess pieces moving on this board. Oh, it's fascinating.
Again, when you get to this point, you understand politics and global trade, you start realizing there's a giant game being played, and you delve a little deeper, you start seeing the pieces.
Yeah, and it is a game. It is absolutely a game. And we are not even pawns.
We're not.
Not at our little level.
At our level, we're not even pawns. We barely register as a mite on the board somewhere.
We're barely spectators.
Yeah. So that's fun. And I see that you put in Robert Reich's free trade article and a link to that. That is in the show notes, available at ORLYRADIO.com for show 124B. So, in conclusion of our bad ideas section, Trump went to Mexico.
Oh, and then he came back.
Unfortunately, he did come back.
No. in some ways, the dumpster fire has reached critical levels after the return. Because his speech on Thursday has blown up in Trumpian fashion.
Okay, so let's see if we can sum up here.
I got this because I went down this rabbit hole before I even posted this.
Oh, actually, there is a video. We could play that.
Yeah, but it's CNN, so it's sort of half done.
Yeah.
From everything, from the multiple sources that I've been pulling from, the current president of Mexico, was it Enrique Peña Nieto, for reasons beyond the reasoning of the citizenry, agreed to have a talk with Trump and then have an appearance with him. Now, Trump's message whilst in Mexico was following the narrative that we've seen so far, which has been him sort of backpedaling from his hardline stances, being more concessionary.
He read from a lot of cards.
Soft-spoken, not firm at all. This is like the weakest we've seen him, to the point where you could almost say he looked afraid. And considering that people were in the streets with effigies of him and burning and beating them, I can't blame him.
Perhaps fear was appropriate. Now, yeah. There are Secret Service teams following him, aren't there? At this point.
Yes, because he's a candidate, but yeah. At the same time, yeah, you've got a detail of 10 Secret Service guys. You have to get out of Mexico City alive.
Olympus has fallen.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
I mean, when you're seeing your effigy burned in the streets, yeah, it's nice to remember you've got guys, armed men,
wow,
who are going to fight and die for you should something happen.
Yeah, but that is kind. That's nice, yeah.
But at the same time, they're still burning effigies of you in the street.
Well, remember, so there were all these statues of him all over the streets of Mexico, and yeah, a lot of those are piñatas and other things.
Yeah, I get there's the spin cycle. But that's after he returns. Now, he was starting to, through, I'm guessing, the shakeup in his campaign, started to be more concessionary when it came to immigration, much to the chagrin of certain conservative pundits.
Yeah.
But he returns, and after the press conference, Mexico's president gets a bunch of flack. I mean, he is getting torn into by the local media, as well as people on the streets, just going, why would you meet with the monster?
Well, in subsequent interviews in Mexico, Peña Nieto reiterated his version of events. He told CNN affiliate Televisa, in an interview late Wednesday, some of the positions Trump has taken are a threat to Mexico.
Yep.
So there's that.
And the Trump was made aware that the people of Mexico had been very insulted. Now, in also tweeting that, and this is where we have Twitter Trump, which is the true Trump. In the president of Mexico actually tweeting,
was it hashtag that, no filter? Yeah.
that he told Trump Mexico's not going to pay for a wall. Trump got angry. And then we have from that tweet Thursday morning, we see old bombastic Trump giving a speech, which has now made it so that of his panel on Hispanic relations for his campaign, which numbers 30 people, 15 are handing in their resignations.
Wait, what?
Yes.
Okay, back that up. Let's say that again for the people in the back that weren't listening.
On Thursday, he gives a speech back here in the States.
Yeah.
And it was more of old Trump, where very bombastic, very anti-Mexican, anti-immigrant.
Just the part about that, about the resignation part.
Because of the speech, again, in his campaign moving forward, they brought in and made together an entire committee on Hispanic relations.
30
numbering strong. 30 people total. 30. Of those 30, 15 are planning to resign, as last I checked, at 8 p.m.
Okay.
And a lot of those people are conservative Latinos. Folks that have been a part of the Latino Republican regimes.
People that people, say that if he didn't win, that we'd have taco trucks on every corner.
Well, those are some of the ones that are staying. No, these are people who have helped prop, who were part of W's campaign.
Okay.
People who have propped him up. People who are conservative pillars in the Latino community. These are people who are in political action communities that help prop up people like Marco Rubio. And again, at first, a number of these folks that were asked on the committee only said yes in hopes of sort of toning Trump down. And that's what they were told, is that you would actually have access in and influence on the campaign's policy moving forward. That they were moving in a different direction. And with this last speech, which just showed them, nope, those were all lies.
Yeah,
he's not changing. Resignation.
Yeah.
Bye. We even had an interview from CNN earlier in the day today where a conservative Latino has come out and pretty much said, I hate Hillary Clinton. And I don't like Donald Trump. I'm kind of surprised that they nominated him, but I said, he's the nominee, so I'm going to try and back him and see where it goes. Well, I'm now actually willing to say it. I am pulling my support for Donald Trump. And that was live on air.
Wow.
Again, he's coming so hardline on this issue that if you have friends in the Hispanic and Latino communities, if you good heavens, if you're a member of the Hispanic and Latino community, it's unconscionable to vote for this man. He has no compassion. None. And he is using the politics of the foreign as his main ways of getting political coverage and getting people to vote for him. He is making a monster out of these people that only he can stand up to and only he can defeat.
It's straw man. It's a standard straw man tactic.
Yeah. And he's playing that card so hard. And
yeah, except he's playing a different game entirely when he actually goes across the border and talks to them.
Oh, yeah, no. But that was actually part of the narrative. Yeah. Again, there's this giant shakeup within his campaign, a number of people were fired. A bunch of people were brought on. We have word that Roger Iles is now a part of the Inner Circle.
Which is just crazy.
and for a while there, he actually was sort of walking back what he said earlier. And again, he already said himself, everything that I say is a suggestion.
Yeah.
But he was walking it back. He then made this trip to Mexico City, where he was sort of contrite, sort of. And again, if you look at that press conference, he is uncomfortable. It just reads all over his body language. And his tone of voice is much more hushed. Something that you don't see.
No,
and then he comes out on Thursday, and it's old vintage Trump, where he is just hardline and yelling loud, bombastic that we are going to deport these people.
Yeah, as it says here in the article, Trump, speaking from prepared remarks, he's reading from cards, of course, was far more measured than in his campaign trail appearances, though he mostly stuck his positions on renegotiating NAFTA and halting illegal immigration. He was also conciliatory. He referred to illegal immigration from Central America rather than just from Mexico. He said a secure barrier would benefit both nations. And he spoke of the flight of jobs, not from the United States, but also from Mexico and Central America to overseas economies. Which is none of his
talking
points.
Going back to the hats in the previous show.
Right, right. Which is
still amazing. I don't know, as we know, we've seen a lot of flights of jobs from the United States to Mexico, especially with, Oreos.
And Carrier.
Yeah, we have the Oreo story from previous shows.
Yeah.
Also, I can say, as just an owner of a Volkswagen, that a lot of the parts for my vehicle were made in Mexico.
A lot of Ford parts also are made in Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, and those used to be parts that were made here in the States.
Mm-hmm.
But the manufacturing plants have moved down to Mexico because cheaper labor. Also, they pay less in taxes.
They come from the chat room, say, Jerry Ann says, I hate to say it, but he's a big bully. I can agree with that somewhat when it comes to Trump, but bullies also tend to have a bit thicker skin than him, and he just seems to snap when a pin drops.
Well, he's very retaliatory in nature. He's insanely impulsive. Again, the reason why Europe is looking at us and going, are you all insane? Is they see a man who is just that impulsive. And do you really want him to have access to the nuclear launch codes?
We have a reality TV star being president.
I mean,
and trying to be, and it's no.
It's one thing when, you have some celebrity, again, going by European perspective and history, some celebrity or noted minor celebrity running for office. Many times in Europe they will get elected. Very rarely will they have a long career. Like, I think Italy had the equivalency of a senator who was a former porn star, if I remember correctly. They have a history of, celebrities being elected, as we do here in the States. But what's the big difference is, in Europe, where they stay in usually one of the lower chambers, we put our celebrities and failed actors as president.
Think for a moment. Let's go ahead and let's brainstorm that Trump has won. Okay?
Crap.
Trump is now president. Now, in comparison, let's take this recent foray into Mexican politics here. as a prime example of his impulsive nature. That was not a really well planned out envoy mission. It was decided Tuesday. It was announced Tuesday. The staff at the U.S. Embassy in Mexico advised the Trump campaign against making such a hastily arranged trip, suggesting it would be logistically difficult to organize on such short notice, according to a source familiar with the discussions. Absolutely. Our president, our sitting president, Obama, there is nothing that he does that isn't planned out months in advance. Nothing. He went on Mark Maron's WTF podcast. I know, weird thing. A president actually sitting in on a podcast. It happened. I listened to the interview. It was good. Huh. But the thing is, Mark Maron does his podcast out of his garage in a residential neighborhood. There were snipers on his roof. There was a tent funneled out from the front of his house all the way out to where it would meet the bulletproof limo. Yeah. The entire neighborhood was cordoned off. There was no line of sight that wasn't available. All of that was because of extreme foreplanning and scheduling. There is nothing that a president can do that is impulsive other than say, actually, I'd rather have a water than a Coke. That's about as far as they can go, really.
As far as you can go is actually a Clinton story, where he goes...
That's true. He did go about as far as you could go.
he went, you know...
He I'm had really some impulses.
I'm really... No.
He had some impulse control problems.
I really have a hankering for this one chicken place. The place in question was in Tennessee. Now, he didn't fly down there, but there was a courier flown to get his order and flown back.
Yeah, that's extreme.
But I think it was something that happened.
I think we can validly say that. Yeah. So...
and on our dime.
But the thing is, that does not put him at risk. Other than for perhaps cholesterol. That's different. The things that Trump was doing, he went to a foreign nation unprepared.
Yeah.
A quite possibly hostile to him foreign nation.
Yeah.
Unprepared. That level of impetuousness does not belong in the Oval Office.
No.
Unless
it's a puppy running around on the floor.
Again, I think it's more, he sees himself as just this almost demigod idea. You know, the teenage invulnerability, oh, nothing's going to happen to me, I'm Donald Trump, let me go ahead and do this thing. I don't have anything to worry about when, guy.
Well, it goes so much deeper than that. I mean, the last time I can think of within U.S. politics that we had a possible president this unhinged was Andrew Jackson. And I actually would look at Jackson's presidency as a good historical reference for possibly what a Trump presidency would look like. Because under Jackson, there was the Trail of Tears. A mass exodus of people forced from their homes. Now, I'm not saying there is going to be a death march like the Trail of Tears was. But, again... The last time we had somebody that seemingly this unhinged, because Jackson murdered people. Okay,
well, that explains
it. He was dueling people while still in office.
He was the military governor of Florida. That explains it.
Well, again, he was famous for the War of 1812, where the Battle of New Orleans, weeks after the treaty had been signed, there's this battle because word hadn't gotten to him yet.
Well, yeah, but that happens.
But no, the guy's kind of a nut. Well, not kind of. No, Jackson was a nut. A violent one. Vehemently violent. And there were a number of things where he was upset about insults to this woman's honor. And this woman actually did a lot of things she was accused of. But he got vehemently angry that somebody would insult her honor, even though she really didn't have any. And got violent. Old Hickory actually was called that because he carried around a hickory staff that he would occasionally hit people with.
Also, apparently he was the one who created the spoils system for American politics, where whichever party won then tended to fill positions with their supporters.
Ah, yes, there it is.
No, this is probably the closest we have in historical context to a possible Trump presidency.
Well, with one, I would say there's one really good exception to that. Andrew Jackson was actually a military man, as opposed to just attending military school. You know, he actually fought.
Yeah.
You know, he probably personally executed people. It's a different level of narcissism. You know, complete megalomania, perhaps, as opposed to just narcissism.
No, he was a man who murdered people. The number of people that he apparently killed in duels varies wildly, depending on the historian. It could have been as few as 12. It could have been as many as 200. We don't know.
I mean, also remember, Trump is single-handedly the healthiest person alive while also having over 30 medical deferments for war.
Well, yeah. According to his bought doctor, of course, yes.
Didn't he have, like, gout? No, he had bone spurs in his foot.
Oh, that's nice.
Which apparently cleared up without surgery, which, medical miracle.
Bone spurs.
Is it just me, or honestly, the more I hear Donald Trump talks and all the things he says, I'm honestly starting to compare him to, like, Kim Jong-il's biographer and what was said about Kim Jong-il.
Yes, going, dear leader, yes.
I'm seeing similarities.
It's miraculous, dear leader. Oh, he
I
was
want to
a,
say that's overstepping, but I can't.
Apparently a lawyer. Okay. Enough of Andrew Jackson, and really enough of Trump. So, I think that's going to wrap it. I can't see any upside to if we were somehow Trump or anyone on his campaign. I can't see an upside to him going to Mexico and doing this.
Well, no. I can see how this was thrown together. Because you have these new people who have Trump's ear, and they're trying to go, hey, we've got an actual election to win. Right now, he's not winning a fake tan contest at this point. So we got to do something to move him more center so he's more marketable. And they've been making these concessions in speeches for a while now. I mean, we had him, you know, not necessarily say, I'm sorry for some of the things I've said, but
he will never do that.
I regret some of the things I've said.
Yeah.
That's the only thing we've gotten from him.
Sorry
but
is
that's
not
still
in his vocabulary. Unless he's still asking for someone else to say it.
Yeah. But still, a more concessionary tone has come out since the change within the campaign. And so this was probably, you know, we need to get you the Latino vote. because the thing that we've tried with the African Americans did not work.
No.
Delivery on that was poor. We can't hang any of our hopes on getting the African American vote. We can't. We've got the white vote. We've got the angry white vote. We've got the down in spades, but that's not going to win us the election. We need to look at our demographics. So the next biggest demographic is the Hispanic vote. And he's done so much damage that, no, I can see being a political strategist, we need to get you in Mexico saying concessionary things, but not looking too soft, and trying to heal that divide. He goes there instead, and they were probably going like, yeah, we'll do this, say, you know, end of October. And he goes, nope, no. Let's get this over with. Let's get this done. Immediately goes there without any planning. And he actually sees that, no, this is an entire nation of people that don't like me. Wow. He reads from prepared statements.
Yeah.
And is sort of shaken at what he's seeing. Can't wait to get out of there. Leaves. And then when the Mexican president goes, this is the narrative, not the narrative that he said.
Mm-hmm.
He flies off the handle and then immediately just goes back to the hardline stance. Especially after he's hearing from, you know, Ann Coulter, who actually has the ear of one of the people on his campaign and is vehemently angry at him that he was being concessionary.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I mean, she just put out a book called Trust in Trump. And that was the very same day that he was concessionary on immigration.
She melted down. Yeah, she melted down like a wax candle in Florida heat.
But with that, I mean, he's taking all this flack from who he sees as his people.
Yeah.
And this weakening message, that's not me. And he goes Thursday. He gets in a rally in front of a bunch of angry white people. Not a person of color in sight, unless they're press.
Yeah.
And just lets loose. Going back to the rapist remarks, and they're not sending their best. And yeah, there may be some good people, but they're not the ones coming here.
No, because that's a brilliant idea. That's exactly the narrative that you certainly want to put forward.
No, we're going to make them pay for that wall. You hear me? I guarantee it. And you have people just fleeing from a sinking ship. And his numbers are down. His numbers are way, way down.
Oh, what was that? There was that interview where the interviewer was, I can't remember her name, caught.
Yeah, no, it was CNN.
Yeah, caught him saying, your poll numbers are down. What polls?
Yeah, that was
all of them. Which ones? All of them.
All of them.
Yeah, that was amazing.
Oh,
and
wow.
The pauses the guy had.
Yeah, because it's like, I can't spin that. that was just the shit. I cannot spin that.
The only way
cannot
you could
spin that.
Upspun that was press harder for the actual polls, and then try and go after those pollsters.
Yeah, that would have been.
On a quick side note, Ann Coulter's book "In Trump We Trust," looking on Amazon, with 188 current reviews. 51% of those reviews are 5-star. 42% of those reviews are 1-star. There is not a single 3-star review.
Wow.
The other 7% are either 4-star or 2-star. But 93% are split between 5 and 1.
I would love for somebody. I'm not saying that any of us should do this, but I think that somebody should just, you know, take a book, I'm not saying what book, but take an old book and just, you know, use it as kindling. you know, a rather old book, shabby something, and just have that as a little YouTube clip and use that as the 3-star review, the single 3-star review saying, well, I did find it have some purpose. So I can't give it a 0. Can't give it a 1.
It kept me warm on a cold night.
Yep, there you go. There you go. It was good for something. Good for something. Whew. Okay. So, enough of Trump. Enough of Trump. Enough of that, whatever we can call that, bombacity. I discovered something today that just amuses me to no end. It's called What Three Words. It's a website, whatthreewords.com, and essentially what they've done is they have divided the world into 10-foot by 10-foot squares, and they have geocoded them each with 3 words in a combination. So, let's say the White House.
1600 Pennsylvania.
Apparently there's White House in London.
1600 Pennsylvania Avenue.
Okay, well, yeah, 1600 Pennsylvania. It's all UK. Okay. That's interesting that it's all UK. Hang on. Because I was able to do it. Why does it think UK? Here we go. There we go. When in doubt, move the map. Okay. So, just Norfolk. That'll be fine. A nice, easy place to take a look at. I say that, screwing it all up. Okay. Wildlife Preserve. There we go. Okay. Hoffer Creek Wildlife Preserve. Let's go over to Twin Pines Road here, right where it begins. That spot is apparently Trapdoor Pals Urgency. As we continue to zoom in, we can see all the little 10-foot by 10-foot squares everywhere. That is now translations, standstill coaching. The next one over, internship reluctantly pressured.
I felt that one.
Shipwreck hive forever. Some of these are fantastic. Circulars infusing secreted. So with this, you can then send the coordinates, you know, to somebody. But this is a 10-foot by 10-foot area. You're going to be able to find somebody in a 10-foot by 10-foot area pretty much anywhere. So if they send you a site that's only 10-foot by 10-foot, you can meet them. So this is sometimes, you know, just a single address has multiples of these even. Imagine trying to figure out in a mall or something like that. You can then specify the exact entrance of which mall you're going to be at. Maybe even, you know, what bench you're going to be sitting on in a park. Something along those lines. So with this kind of thing, you can really break down the world into a very itemized area. And I encourage more people to use this because I just think it's brilliant.
Can you search by just the three words, though?
I think you can. Let's see here. So let me punch in just what we've got. Yes, you can punch it in. You have to have the word, dot, no space, word, dot, no space, word. And then that will then come up with exactly where it is. So apparently there is also a circular infusing secreted near somewhere in Australia. So perhaps they've duplicated some of these. So you might need to figure out the country.
There are only so many words in the English language.
There are, yeah. But
even a 3x3,
it looks like it's in the middle of nowhere.
It is absolutely in the middle of nowhere right there. Australia is a big place.
But, it's a continent.
But you would be able to find it.
You want to find that one particular Aboriginal hut?
So
there you go.
So circulars infusing secreted. There's also another, there's one in Virginia. That's the one that we were looking at. But there's also another one in Arizona. So yeah, there is some duplication, but I think that the geographical regions are enough separated that you can figure it out from other things. Like, you know, if you're talking to somebody in particular, you might know what country they're in. That could definitely help. Or, in this case, what coast they're on. So, does it take me back? It takes me exactly back to where it was. And you can then, you know, you can look around, you can move... unlock pin, there we go. So there's a lot of different features we could do. Oh, okay, so they've got the map, satellite map with labels, the ESRI map, which shows you some different subdivision geo-coordinates. Satellite, more of that, and also OpenStreetMap, which is what you're probably going to see on your GPS, and I don't know what Mapbox is, but I like the look of it. But the ESRI, that's really interesting, because that shows all sorts of things, including, like, wetlands information. Which, by the way, even out in the water, there's locations. It's the whole world has been overlaid with a 10x10 grid. What you going to do with it? What are you going to do with a 10x10 grid where you can map out your entire neighborhood or the entire world and tell people to meet you at that one place that one time where you left that thing?
I will use this for a LARP or a tabletop RPG. That's what I'm going to use it for.
It could be a lot of fun.
Shadowrun with this technology. Have fun with it.
Yeah.
Shadowrun LARP. This is how you pull it off. It's the beginning.
Wedge juicing implanted.
Ugh.
Multiples underlay fattest. Thankful inclination simplest. I just love some of the combinations. Redrawn dodgy verb.
Just watch out for that verb.
Hired teacups polo.
I see an apples to apples sort of game.
Yeah.
Permutation of this.
Ooh, that could be interesting. That could be interesting. There is also an Android app and there is also an iPhone app. So you can pull those up, and of course you can also go to the website. It is still in early development. So
well, there is my life of figuring out where what exactly my desk is named at work.
Yeah, it could be very interesting. I noticed that the GPS on my phone was putting me in various places in the complex that I was at earlier today. So I couldn't figure out exactly which 10x10 square I was supposed to be on. So, individual mileage may vary. So, enjoy that. That is whatthenumber3words.com. It looks like a lot of fun. And it is a lot of fun.
Download it on my phone now.
Okay. Well, before you do that, Stephen, you have one listed here in the personal picks. Daniel, do you have one?
Not this week.
Not this week. Okay, cool. No problem. Steven, you've got more awesome science stuff from YouTube because, of course, science.
Actually, this is
science.
Yes, it's Because Science with Kevin Hill. He actually is part of the Nerdist, and
Kyle,
he does these weekly podcasts or weekly little shows.
Well, weekly segments.
Yeah. Where he literally takes these interesting questions like, why
from
don't lightsabers burn your hand off? Or would a Futurama-sized ice cube stop global warming? For all those who are fans of the anime, how strong could One Punch Man really be? Sci-fi's transporters or science fiction, or Star Trek's transporters or sci-fi's most important technology? Or can Thor's hammer stop the juggernaut? You know, really important questions. But then he actually throws science at it and figures out all these things. Like, what could happen? How does it actually happen? What principles are at work here to make these things occur? Or can this thing actually happen based off the principles shown? And, you know, they're 5 minutes, 6 minutes, 8 minutes. I think the longest he's ever done is like ten.
How does cat dog poop?
Yeah.
Oh.
He has things like that. And it's just these really weird, usually nerd questions.
Could Wolverine get a tattoo?
Mm-hmm.
It wouldn't last
How
very long.
How acidic is the xenomorph blood from Alien?
It's pretty bad. I know that.
Why does Nuka-Cola Quantum glow blue?
Strontium 90.
Oh, no spoilers. Come on.
No.
No, it's actually in the game.
That's actually in the game. Strontium 90.
I know, but the people have to play the game, too. Why don't the Walking Dead zombies decompose?
Mm-hmm.
Is the X-Files' Agent Mulder crazy?
Where a vampire should bite.
Hmm.
But you go through all of these things, you know, it's...
With science.
What, over 100... I'm sorry, there's exactly 101 videos currently.
How many?
And he,
how many calories are in the Stay Puffed Marshmallow Man?
Again,
I need to know these things.
But they're fat. He's definitely a nerd, hardcore science guy, but hardcore nerd.
Well, he actually did a chart for what is the best of the three starting Pokemon. He actually made a chart to find out which of the three starters is best Pokemon.
Yeah, no, I love his stuff.
How do Pokeballs really work?
Hardcore edutainment.
And you can watch these all right before we actually get the first episode of Bill Nye's new talk show that's going to be airing on Netflix.
Ah, yes, that's right. That's right. Yeah, that's, boy, is that controversial, which it really shouldn't be, but it is.
Why is it controversial?
Because...
Quick break?
Because... Oh, man. Because. Hang on.
Science.
let me find the thing that I've been waiting to share that says exactly why. It's unpleasant is why. Because it has some little factoids in it that... It's, of course, a meme, but, you know, it's one of those things that actually makes sense. Nope, that wasn't it. There it is. Got it. Because 42% of the United States believe in creationism, 31% believe that humans' present form hasn't changed since their creation, 70% believe in angels, 51% don't trust the Big Bang Theory, 37% believe that climate change is a hoax, 1 in 4 Americans believe that the sun revolves around the Earth, and 22 million Americans believe that all the moon landings were fake, and 12 million Americans think that lizard people control the government. That's why it's controversial.
That's fair.
Best net education.
I mean, all of that's wrong except for the lizard people. Let's be honest here. Now, if Trump gets elected, I think they'll just give up on the government and go back to their holes. I mean,
that clearly
was not their plan.
That or they will have won.
Either way.
But, you know, if there are lizard people running the government, they've already won.
They've done a piss-poor job of doing it. I mean, come on,
guys.
Yeah,
I mean, really. Do you need to really blame them, you know, because we're that... You don't think that we can be inept enough, you know, to be that? No. It's
true.
So terrible.
Never underestimate stupidity in large numbers.
Oh, yeah, that's pretty much the way it is. Okay. Anything left to say? Or are we done?
Nope. Just go to the YouTube channel. Watch it. It's cool.
Sounds good. It does look awfully entertaining, and I do need to know... How many calories are in the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man?
A lot.
That's important information that is vital to my sustenance, apparently, in life. Okay. Well, that is it for tonight and, of course, for the 124 series. We'll be back live next Friday about 9:30 p.m. Eastern, as long as everything holds together. Hear me, baby? Hold together. In the meantime, nice. The conversations continue on the web. Head over to ORLYRADIO.com. That's ORLYRADIO.com for all the links right at the top of the page so you can watch us live, like us on Facebook. Yeah, that's it. Follow us on Twitter, Tumblr, Google+, and subscribe to the YouTube channel and also the Twitch channel. That way, you can watch us live and join in all the fun, and you can do that right from our own webpage at ORLYRADIO.com. If you have stayed with us all the way through the credits, my God, man, you're crazy. Thank you. Thank you, though. How about you give us a hand? If you have a few dollars to spare, you can contribute to the Patreon page, and that'll get, as a patron, you'll get early access to show releases and maybe even a special perk here and there. Just follow the Patreon link to the webpage, and that'll take you over to patreon.com/ORLYRADIO. You can also make a one-time donation via the donate button. And, you know, if you can't fit us into your rainy day funds, totally understand. How about you do us a solid and share the show and leave us a review? We're always looking for new ideas for the show. So how about you share those with us? Share what's on your mind. Shoot us a note to orlyradiopodcast@gmail.com. Or if you're the more talkative sort, how about 470-222-6759? That number is always ready to take your call or text. We can't thank you enough for spending some time with us. A lot of time with us. So until next time, this has been ORLY Radio, part of the Cowen Services Network. Music for the show was created by Kevin McLeod of incomptech.com. Thanks, everybody. Toodles! Bye-bye!